Kimraha Hula Dunya. Welcome to Beale Scott, the Celtic Podcast. Welcome back. Hope you all been studying your Gaelic. Yeah, they really, in Scotland, they want you to say Gaelic, not Gaelic. In Ireland, of course, they call it Gaelic, or they were actually trying to call it Irish. But, just keep working on it. Keep plugging away. This week I've been working hard on learning some stories. With Halloween looming in a few months, I wanted to put together some Celtic stories and some good scary ones, and maybe get three or four of them put together and maybe have a little storytelling session. I've been working with my granddaughter, giving her some basic Gaelic words, working with her on her numbers and hellos and goodbyes and good evenings, and she seems to love it. The trivia question for today: who in Irish mythology is referred to as the Hound of Ulster? Now, I'll give you the answer to that later on at the end of the program. For now, though, we're going to get started with a little music to brighten your day. That song was En Chor Og. It's from the Gaelic music and song album, Sky the Island. It's good to hear a little Gaelic music, let you hear what it sounds like in use. Now, we're going to proceed to Fecamich Beckin Gaelic. Let's try a little Gaelic. And we're going to continue with our work on the verb to be. Now, all verbs have what is known as an independent form for the verb to be, which is ha. Which, as you saw above, or you see above, is used to form positive statements. All verbs have another form, the dependent. This is used to form the negative statement and interrogatives, question forms, for the present tense of the verb to be. So you've got the independent, which is ha, T-H-A, and the dependent, which is veil, B-H-E-I-L. Ha for positive statements, an example would be ha ifur, it is cold. And for a negative statement, it would be chenil for negative statements, chenil ifur, it is not cold. A veil for asking a question or interrogative. Avail ifur, is it cold? And then for the negative of asking a question, for a negative question, nakil ifur, is it not cold? Which is kind of odd way of saying something, but if you needed to say it, you could. In addition, you also find the form mvail, A-M-B-H-E-I-L. Some phrases to translate into English to give you a little practice working on these two different forms. So we're going to start with number one, mvail uski. Now you'll use some of the vocabulary you've already picked up in last week's sessions. I'll still post it up on the board. Nakael ifluk, Haniel yetreng, Haniel shinfur, Nakael yet leshk, Avail shifur, or ur. And then I also want you to try, get your little pen and paper out, and try translating some of these English into Gaelic. So we'll start with number one. I am not cold. Number two, are you warm? Number three, are you not warm? Number four, is she tired? Number five, are they pleased? And number six, isn't she nice? All right. Now, this is a little bit of a refresher from our very first podcast on how to say, how are you? Which is Kimaraha Shif or Kimaraha U in the informal. And then, of course, some of the replies, which are Hami Gama, I'm good. Hami Dona, I'm bad. Hami Chin, I'm sick. And so on. So today, it was a real quick lesson there on the verb to be and the forms, the independent and dependent forms. All right. Now, of course, I'll have all this up on the screen, just like I did in the last podcast, to help you out. Shul ka tarasa ka seli mo. All right, this song was Sularoon by Celtic Women. It means Walk My Love. It's a great Gaelic tune. And if you've never heard of the Celtic Women, you must have been living on another planet, because they've been pretty much, they've been kicking butt for years now, about the last 15 or so years. Well over 10 million albums sold, 3 million tickets sold to their concerts or more by now. The Celtic Women are very good at bringing the Gaelic and the Celtic music to popular sites, bringing it out into the popularizing, making it so everybody gets to hear it, I guess. The Celtic Women, they're made up of some really awesome singers. Tara McNeil and Susan McFadden, Merritt Carlin, Eva McMahon, Meave, I can't even pronounce her name. But the violinist, Meredith Nesbitt, she's awesome. Let me try. I'm going to have to give her due diligence here. Meave Navolkaha. Oh, wow. That's a tough one. I'm going to have to listen to her or say her name once to get it. Some of these, the way they throw they intermix the consonants and throw around the vowels, sometimes it gets kind of confusing. But that song, Celtic Women, from the Celtic Women, is going to lead us right into our Celtic history break, which is all about women, Celtic women in history. Now, the first century historian before, first century BC historian, Diodorus Siculus, wrote of the Celts that they have bronze helmets with tall crests, which give their wearers the appearance of enormous height. Now, he also wrote, he wrote a lot about the Celtic warriors, but he also wrote that the Celtic women were not only equal to their men in stature, but rivaled them in strength as well. Cartamandua, a Celtic queen in Britain, was known as a fearless leader of her people. Roman writer Dio Cassius recorded that Celtic queen Boudica was huge of frame and terrifying of aspect. A mass of bright red hair fell to her knees. While Boudica undoubtedly made an imposing figure, it is known that Celtic historians were sometimes guilty of exaggeration. But we don't know that for sure now, do we? Unlike their men, Celtic women were vain and took good care of their appearance, using decorated bronze mirrors that were made. They made themselves the works of art. They wore makeup by darkening their eyebrows with berry juice and reddening their cheeks with an herb called rue. They painted their fingernails, wore finger and ankle rings, and put their hair in braids, sometimes arranged atop their heads in elaborate configures. They embroidered their clothing with gold or silver, and they moved to the sound of tinkling necklaces and bracelets. In contemporary Rome, the poet Propertius scolded his mistress for making up herself like a Celt. So, I guess the Celts were pretty bawdy. Celtic women were the world's first with equal rights. In an age when Roman wives were mere chattel to their Roman husbands, they were not even allowed to own property, Celtic women were far ahead of their time in enjoying equal rights with their men. In Celtic society, a woman continued to control all of her personal possessions after her marriage. Celtic women often fought alongside their men and awed the Romans with their valor and their prowess in battle. Some women even ruled as chiefs on their own merits. The goddess of war was but one of several important female Celtic deities. Now, the fact that Celtic women were I major part of any Celtic army as part of the reason why the Celts were actually able to sack Rome in 390 BC, making up almost a third of the warriors used in that siege. But a lot of you didn't know that the Celts took Rome. They did a lot of damage too. But we'll get to that in a later history break. And that's it for today. Goodness gracious. We're just going to head on out to some more music. And this next band is a band from Texas. It's called Needfire. I normally tell you all this after the song, but this band I kind of grew up on. They were playing at all the festivals we used to go to, and we got to meet the guys. Somewhere around here I got a set of drumsticks that they autographed. But they're kind of like a Celtic rock band that uses bagpipes and didgeridoos and everything else to get you a real kind of Celtic rocky sound. It's kind of cool. I like it. And you just tell me what you think.
Rockin' all over the world.
All right. I told you you'd like that band Lead Fire. They're pretty good. You can probably find their stuff on Amazon. It's called Need Fire. It's pretty simple. But yeah, that's some good Celtic music right there. Now we're going to head off to do Everyday Celtic Ways. Now, like I said in the beginning of this podcast, I'm starting to work on some Celtic stories. And like I said, with Halloween coming up, I'm trying to look for more scarier ones. Some with a little horror, a little thriller to them. And the one that always struck me, we had this storyteller that used to come to the festivals. His name is John Burleson. And he always told this story. It was actually on one of his CDs called The Winding Way. You can find that on Amazon as well, I'm sure. It's a story called Mary Culhane and a Dead Man. Now, excuse me. Ugh. Storytelling isn't uniquely Celtic. But I sure do a good job of it. And the tradition is something that is proudly passed on. This story has had many authors, but none are known to be the first. It goes back so far into our history. Storytelling is definitely a Celtic trait that is part of your everyday Celtic way. Mary Culhane and the Dead Man. Now, Mary Culhane lived in Faraway, Ireland. She was the oldest of six children, and they were very poor. Dirt poor, you might say. For her father earned a living by digging graves at the graveyard at the very edge of town. One day, her father came home. Bone tired he was, and he plopped himself down in the nearest chair. She heard him exclaim, "Hey, I can't believe it. I left me prized blackthorn walking stick back at the tree. The only thing my dear father gave me, and it will probably be gone by morning." Mary Culhane ran to her shawl. "I'll get it for you, father." And she ran out the door before anybody could stop her. For no one went into the cemetery after dark, even a gravedigger. And indeed, it was dark before she got there. A big moon was just on the horizon as she entered the cemetery gate. She had been here many times before, and graveyards didn't scare her. She carefully walked around the graves, for she had been taught from time that she was a wee lass to not walk over them. It was bad luck. She picked her way around the graves until she saw the walking stick lying against an old oak tree. Why, her father must have stopped there to have his lunch and forgot it. Then Mary Culhane forgot to watch where she was stepping, and she fell into an open grave. As quickly as she could, she got up on her hands and knees, but as she did, she felt someone, or something, crawl onto her back. An evil voice whispered into her ear, "Hey, Mary Culhane, I've been waiting for you. Now you must take me in town to get me something to eat, for I am hungry and thirsty." Mary knew. She knew this was an evil creature. She could tell by its scaly fingers and its fetid breath. Mary suddenly had no will of her own. She was helpless to do only as the evil creature bade her to do. She reached up to the top of the grave and pulled with all her strength. She felt as if she were bearing the weight of the world on her shoulders. But somehow she managed to lift herself and the creature onto the soft grass. She lay there prone while the creature screamed, "Get up, Mary Culhane, get up and take me into town." Mary slowly rose, and with that creature riding her back, she trudged towards the village. They came to the main road where the first house appeared. "Now, Mary Culhane, take me into this house so I may feed." Mary reached for the first step, the second step, and was ready to reach for the third when the creature cried out, "Not here, Mary Culhane, for I smell the stench of holy water." Mary stepped down and went to the second house. Now, Mary Culhane, bring me inside this house. But again, as she reached the third step, The creature cried in pure agony. No, Mary Culhane. Take me away, for I smell the stench of holy water. Mary again retreated and walked down the road until they came to the third house. She took the first step, the second, and the third. The creature said not a word. Take me into this house, into the kitchen, Mary, and find something for me to eat. Mary walked down the darkening hallway to the kitchen. There, she let the creature slide off her back and onto a chair. Quickly, quickly, Mary Culhane, I don't have much time. Mary looked all about. Finally, she said, I'm sorry, all that I can find is some oatmeal and some dirty water. Ah, Mary Culhane, I will teach these people not to leave me anything. Let me on your back. Again, Mary did as the creature commanded her to do. Now take me up these stairs. No, no, Mary screamed. For she knew this family, and she knew that the three boys, her classmates, slept upstairs. But she was powerless under the weight of the evil one's spell. She slowly made her way to the top of the stairs, and there in the moonlight she could barely make out the figures of the three boys fast asleep. The creature slid off her back and went over to each boy. He took out a sharp knife and slit each boy's finger. With the first drop of blood, their breathing stopped. With the second drop of blood, their hearts stopped. And the third drop of blood, all the life left their bodies. He took the vial of blood and climbed onto Mary's back. Take me back down into the kitchen, Mary Culhane, so I may feast. Mary sadly walked down the stairs and into the kitchen. The creature slid off Mary's back and onto the chair. He took the oatmeal and poured it into two bowls. Then he took the vial of blood and began to pour it over the oatmeal. When he finished, he gave one bowl to Mary and said, Now eat this. No, no, she cried. She could not eat this bloody gruel, not stained with the blood of her friends. Do it, and do it now. She picked up a spoon and brought a spoonful to her lips. The creature, satisfied, picked up his bowl and began to greedily gobble his portion down. Mary saw her chance. She quickly, spoonful by bloody spoonful, put the tainted oatmeal into the neckerchief around her neck. She just finished when the creature put down his bowl. Ah, Mary Culhane, I see you are done. Now clean up this place so no one will know we were here. Mary reached for the two bowls and began to wash them out. She waited until the creature turned away and put the neckerchief and the two bowls in the cabinet. Hurry, Mary Culhane. I must get back to my grave before morning. She slowly walked over, and again, he positioned himself on her back. She turned to go back down the hallway. No, Mary Culhane, we cannot leave by the way we came, for 'tis the way of all evil creatures. They must return by a different path. So Mary turned around and went out the back door. She was ready to walk down the steps when the creature laughed, his insane laughter. Ah, ha, ha, Mary! Mary Culhane, tell me what you see. Mary looked out on the horizon. I see three hills. They're called the Haunted Hills. Do you know why, Mary Culhane? I'll tell you why. Because buried in that middle mound is all the gold and silver the evil ones have gathered over the many years. But only the dead know of it. Now Mary Culhane began to fear for her own life, for now she knew of the gold. On and on into the night they went, the creature laughing, taunting, telling her stories, evil stories that no one wants to hear. The moon set in the western sky, throwing the sky into pitch black. Finally, they started to approach the cemetery by the back road. As they did, a rooster crowed. Ah, Mary Culhane, what is that awful noise? Mary knew full well it was a rooster, and that morning must be nigh. It must be close. But she said, 'Tis nothing but the bleating of a sheep. Hurry, Mulclane, hurry! Mary reached the graveyard and was trying to find her way around the graves when the inky black sky turned a soft gray, and again they heard the rooster crowing. Ah, Mary Cully, what is that foul noise? It is nothing, nothing, I say, but the barking of a dog. Quickly, quickly, Mary Cully, for I feel myself weakening. Mary saw the oak tree. She saw the open grave. She walked slowly towards it. Just then, the sky broke open, and the first beam of morning dew across the sky and into the graveyard. The rooster crowed three times, for the third time. Mary felt the creature fall from her shoulders and into the pit. As it did, it cried, Ah, Mary Culhane, if I were to know that you were to live, I never would have told you of the gold. Suddenly a great weight had been lifted from her shoulders, and at once she had her will to do as she would. She glanced down in the grave, but all she saw there were whitened bones of the evil creature. She grabbed her father's walking stick and used it as she hurried home. She threw herself onto her bed and into a deep sleep to forget all the horrors of that horrid evening. A couple hours passed when her mother burst into her room. Mary, Mary, wake up. Something terrible has happened in town. Mary, please wake up. Mary stirred, and her mother could see that her hair was matted and tangled, and darkened circles smudged her eyes. Her dress was dirty, and it looked like blood stained on her apron. She backed out of the room. Mary, get some sleep, but meet us at your friend's home, the one with the three boys. Something's wrong. Mary again fell into a deep sleep, but this time it was full of dreams. Dreams of an evil creature, the boys, the knife, the blood. Oh, the blood. Then she suddenly awoke. She realized it wasn't a dream. It had happened, but she remembered something else. As they were walking back to the graveyard, she had asked the evil creature if there wasn't some way that the boys could have lived. The creature just laughed. Ah, Mary Culhane, there was a way. There's always a way, you see. If they were to drink of their own blood, they could live. But as you ate your portion, now there's no way. Aha, Mary thought. But there was a way. She hadn't eaten her portion. Maybe, just maybe. She burst out of bed, bathed, and put on a fresh dress and headed towards town. When she got to the boys' home, she could see that the entire village was trying to console the desolate parents. She went up to the father and said, Please, please let me inside. No, Mary, I can't do that. What is upstairs in that bedroom is not fit for a young lass to see. But you don't understand. I think I know a way to save their lives. I beg you. Ah, Mary, if you could save my three sons' lives, I would give you anything, anything in my power to give. I ask nothing. Just let me go in alone. The father cleared the house, and Mary entered. She walked down the darkened hallway to the kitchen. She opened the cabinet, and there was the neckerchief right where she had left it. She grabbed a spoon and went up those stairs. She saw the lifeless forms of the three boys. She gently went over and put the spoon to their lips, and with the first drop of blood, the boys again began to breathe, and with the second drop of blood, their hearts started to beat, and with the third drop of blood, all life came back to their bodies. And what rejoicing there was when Mary walked outside and behind her, the three boys, alive and well. For 3 days and three nights there was a celebration, like none before. And on the third night, the father came to Mary. Mary, you have made me the happiest man to ever live. You gave me my boys back. And Mary, I want to give you something, anything, just name it. Please, Mary, tell me. Mary said, Well, would you deed me the land behind your house, the one with the three hills on it? I'll give you that and much more, he said. So right there, they wrote up a contract. When Mary became of age, she married the oldest of the three boys. And don't you know that they built the foundation of their house between the two hills? And when they dug down, they found gold and jewels and silver. There was enough that Mary Culhane was the richest woman, and her father never had to pick up another shovel again. And even though the events of that night slowly faded away like a bad dream, there was something Mary Culhane never forgot, and that was to keep holy water at the front door. I hope you liked the story. I always have. And that's it for Everyday Celtic Ways. As always, I appreciate you listening to my the Yield Scott Celtic podcast. I hope you get a little bit of Gaelic language and a little bit of history and a little bit of fun. I hope you liked the story. I noticed the other day, and I was looking up to find out when here in the St. Louis area we always have a Scottish festival, and it doesn't look like we're going to have one this year. And they're not advertising it for 2019, they're advertising for next year. So I think I might just have to find one over in Illinois somewhere. I know there should be pretty much anywhere around a major, well, any state really, not even around a major city, you can find Celtic festivals all year long. That phone of mine keeps going off. Tonight's trivia question: who was the Hound of Ulster? That's Cuchulainn, or Cuchulainn. I don't know how to pronounce it. But anyway, I appreciate you guys listening, and I'm going to let you go with a little bit of music tonight. So, Martian Leave and Drosda, bye for now. Thank you a lot.
Sailing ships and sailing men will sail the open water, where the only thing that matters is the wind inside the main. So all you loving mothers, keep your eyes upon your daughters, for the sails will mend their tatters and the mast will rise again. You can see the squares of canvas dancing over the horizon. You can hear the shanty waving to the heaving of the men. You can feel the seas up to your knees, and you know the sea is rising, and you know the clipper's day has come again. To the men on high, the bosun's cry commands a killing strain, till every mother's son begins to pray. With a hearty shout, she comes about and heads into the rain, and the ship has never seen a better day. Sailing ships and sailing men will sail the open water, where the only thing that matters is the wind inside the main. So all you loving mothers, keep your eyes upon your daughters, for the sails will mend their tatters and the mast will rise again. And human dreams are all that makes her go, and the magic of the wind upon her sails. We'd rather fight the weather than the fishes down below. God help us if the rigging ever fails. As the timber creaks, the captain speaks above, the vessel groans, till every soul on board can hear the call. Well, it's nothing but the singing of the ship inside her bones, and this is when she likes it best of all. Sailing ships and sailing men will sail the open water, where the only thing that matters is the wind inside the main. So all you loving mothers, keep your eyes upon your daughters, for the sails will mend their tatters and the mast will rise again.
'cause the Clipper's nose is plowing fields of green. Where fortune takes the cruise, we wish them well. Where men can be when lost at sea is somewhere in between the regions of a heaven and a hell. They'll be sailing eastern harbors and the California shore. If you set your mind to see them, then you can. As you count each mast go sailing past, you're prouder than before, and you know the Clipper's day has come again.